Good morning and grace and peace to you. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We welcome you to our worship service today and special welcome to any guests or visitors who might be with us today. We'd encourage you as well as everyone to sign in on the registration cards found in the pew. We would like to invite you to stay for a time of coffee and fellowship following the worship service today. And we'd like to welcome those listening in to our videotape ministry, those at Sibley Specialty Care, Countryview Manor, Hartwood Heights, as well as our shut-ins and homebound. I do have a few announcements to draw your attention to. Some are not in the bulletin. One is the nominating committee would like to have a quick meeting after church in the overflow room. And then anyone who's involved in any of the major committees of property and finance, Christian Ed, Mission and Nurture, Worship and Evangelism, we want to take pictures for the pictorial directory in the front of the church here right after the church service. So hopefully we can gather everybody quickly. We're going to basically take a picture of who we all have here. We know we'll miss some, but if you'd come up front after church for that. Also, choir practice. We'll practice today after the service. You're going to sing next Sunday on November 24th. And then movie night, we have a preview to show you of the movie Greater. And we'll see if we can get that on the screens for you now. Come tonight and bring your own drinks, and we'll have popcorn for you for tonight for that show. Family Night Out is also going to be this week at 6 o'clock, and we'll be serving a Thanksgiving meal. There's not too many signed up yet, but we're still allowing people to sign up for it. There is not going to be a program, but if you'd like to come with your family and your kids, come at 6 o'clock, no charge for the meal, and again, it will be a regular Thanksgiving meal will be served. For the Thanksgiving dinner volunteer sign-up and invitations, we've gotten all of our food. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And we do still need people to help to work on that day. So if you can help in that way. And then there's some reminders in the bulletin about when to drop off the food and such. Next Sunday will be the Christ the King Sunday, and we'll be serving the communion on that day. And also, for those who didn't order pictures when you were taking pictures with the pictorial directory, we have several of the 8x10 on the secretary's desk if you'd like to pick them up. And then I was told that Randy and Colleen Goldhorn, it's their 41st anniversary today. So congratulations, Randy and Colleen. And then for sympathy concerns, we got a call this morning. Paul Ryder, his brother, and Ruby's, Jansen's brother, Ronald from Lamar's, passed away this morning. So we want to pray for those families at Ronald's passing. For a prayer chain of concerns, Sheila Soderquist fell this last weekend. She cracked and fractured some ribs. She's in the nursing home recovering. And so we want to pray for her at Country View Manor. Mackenzie Ryder was having some severe headaches, and she got her appointment moved up in Rochester from January to December, but they're still trying to get in even this month if they can. So pray that that will happen. Nelvin Pompkes was in the hospital in Navarre McKinnon for about 2.5 weeks. She's now returned home, and she is gaining in strength. So continue to pray for her. Those are the updates that I have. Any other joys or concerns anyone would like to share at this time? Yes, Colleen.
Just to share with on the 17th of November,
Oh, okay. So it's Ricky Dirk's birthday today as well. So happy birthday to Ricky. All right. Shall we stand and greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ? My heart, O God,
make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay.
Good morning. Will you join me in the call to worship? In Christ, we are made new and filled with hope. In God, we belong to a new community, discovering we are friends, sisters. In Christ, the old ways have lost their glitter and appeal, for we have turned toward the new light. In God, we receive a new name. In Christ, we are a new creation. The old is passed away.
Because of God's plan for salvation, we look forward to Christ's return.
Will you bow your heads in prayer? Your word, O God, is living and active, a powerful means by which you speak to us. Give us ears to hear what you are saying rather than hearing only what we want to hear. Give us courage to measure our attitude and actions by your truth and the desire to align our lives by your call to discipleship. Enlighten us with your Holy Spirit and set our hearts ablaze with the yearning to know you and love you ever more deeply. Amen. Our opening hymn is, O God, Our Help in Ages Past, number 52 in your hymnal, and I assume on the screen. Will you join me in the unison prayer of confession? Almighty God, our Father, you are holy. We confess that in the light of your purity, we see our own impurities. We truly have fallen short of the expectations you have of us. Forgive us. In the name of Christ, who died to reconcile us to you, please come to our aid. Lead us from the paths of disaster and direct us toward holiness. Teach us to pray as the saints have prayed. Teach us to love as the godly have loved. And teach us to serve without counting the cost, as your true servants have done throughout time. Grant us the courage to dare to be Christians in reality rather than in pretense, however difficult it may be. Most of all, help us to stand firm in the faith, even if the world around us is falling apart. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hear the good news. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. So you must consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive in Christ Jesus our Lord. Friends, believe in the good news of the gospel, for in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Well, if that doesn't get you in the mood for Thanksgiving, I'm not sure what would. That was very, very, very good. At this time, we're going to have a children's message, so I invite the children to come forward for that. Tracy Van Diepen has a message to share. I'm using number 4. There you go. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Come on up. Come join. Okay, how's everybody today? Good. It's kind of nice outside. Maybe you can play outside later. That's kind of fun. Okay, so today, what Pastor Terry is going to talk about a little bit later is he is going to talk about the second time that Jesus is going to come. Okay, so when was the first time that Jesus came? We're going to celebrate it pretty soon. We call it Jesus' birthday. Right. He came a long, long time ago, and we celebrated at Christmas time. That was the first time he came. Well, and then he lived, right? And he did great things. And then what happened around Easter time? He died on the cross. And why did he do that? To save us from our sins and so we can go to heaven someday and be with him. Okay, so then Jesus, that was the first time Jesus came. And then after he died on the cross, 40 days later, he went to heaven to be with God. And Jesus is going to come again. He's going to come a second time. Did you guys know that? Okay, so that's pretty crazy all by itself, right? He's going to come a second time. And when he comes this second time, then our Bibles tell us that there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. And those that have Jesus in their heart are going to go live in heaven with Jesus forever, okay? So if we're still here when that happens, that means Jesus is going to come take us to heaven. So there's a few things that we need to do to get prepared for that. So I have a question for you. If you guys, those of you that are in school, Damien, if you have a test on Friday, what do you think you should do for it?
Study.
Damien says he should study for his test. Okay. Okay, so I have another question for some of you that are a little bit younger. Okay, Aaliyah, what if your grandma told you that if you could say your ABCs all the way through to Z by the time that she saw you the next time, that she would take you to the porch on Main for an ice cream cone, what would you do?
Get gloves.
Would you study your ABCs? Would you sing them all the time in the house? You wouldn't? Do you like ice cream? You do like ice cream. Would you want to be able to say your ABCs for Grandma the next time she came so she could take you to the porch? You would. Okay. So I have a vision in my head that you would be singing it all the time. You would practice it, wouldn't you? And you would study it. Okay. So when Jesus comes the second time, he is going to look over our lives, and he's going to see if we did all the things that he's hoping we do and all the things that he's laid out for us to do. So what we need to do, Damien told me he'd study. Aaliyah's going to practice. What do you think we could study so that we're ready for when Jesus comes? Read the Bible. The Bible tells us all kinds of good things. It tells us how we should live our lives. Do you guys think it tells us how we should treat people, other people? Right, it tells us how we should treat other people and how we can be good friends and how we can share our love for Jesus with other people so that they can go to heaven the second time that he comes. And then you know what? It also tells us ways that we can practice it. We don't just want to read it and keep it in our head, do we? We need to practice it. Do we get really good at something if we practice? Yep. So if, JC, do you like to play basketball? Or softball? Basketball? Do you practice? So if you practice, would you get better and better and better? You would. So when we practice the things that are in the Bible, we get better and better and better at it. Okay, so I would like to encourage you all to pick up your Bibles and start to read them and learn those stories and learn all the things that Jesus has in there for us because it's good stuff. Okay? All right, let's have a prayer and then I have a treat for you. Dear God in heaven, thank you so much for letting all our friends come be with us here today and for us to learn more about your word and how about exciting it's going to be when you send your son Jesus back for the second time and how that we need to be prepared so that when he comes, we are ready so he can look at us and say, oh, well done, my good and faithful servant. Help us to live our lives as best we can for Jesus and help us to become as much as we can like Jesus. Amen. Okay, I have a treat for all of you for being super listeners.
Our Old Testament reading comes from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 25. And this is called in my Bible, A New Heaven and a New Earth. Behold, I will create new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I will create. For I will create Jerusalem to be a delight and its people a joy. I will rejoice over Jerusalem and take delight in my people. The sound of weeping and of crying will be heard in it no more. Never again will there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not live out his years. He who dies at 100 will be thought a mere youth. He who fails to reach 100 will be considered accursed. They will build houses and dwell in them. They will plant vineyards and eat their fruit. No longer will they build houses and others live in them, or plant and others eat. For as the days of a tree, so will be the days of my people. My chosen ones will long enjoy the work of their hands. They will not toil in vain or bear children doomed to misfortune. For they will be a people blessed by the Lord, they and their descendants with them. Before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb will feed together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. But dust will be the serpent's food. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Okay, hymn of preparation, One Day, please stand, number 170.
Justified freely forever. One day.
Will you please remain standing for our gospel reading? And we'll be looking at the lectionary text today from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 21, verses 5 through 19. Hear now the reading of the Lord's word. Some of the disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned in beautiful stones with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus said, "As for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down." "Teacher," they asked, "when will all these things happen? And what will be the signs that they are about to take place?" And he replied, "Watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name, claiming I am he, and a time is near. Do not follow them. And when you hear of wars and revolutions, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away." And then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilence in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. But before all this, they will lay hands on you and persecute you. And they will deliver you to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. This will result in your being witnesses to them. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourself. For I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed by even your parents, brothers, relatives, and friends. And they will even put some of you to death. All men will hate you because of me, but not a hair on your head will perish. By standing firm in the faith, you will gain life." The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, the actions of our life be acceptable, O Lord, as you are our rock and you are our redeemer. Amen. Situational awareness is something winning NFL quarterbacks have a knack for. They just seem to know, they have eyes in the back of their head when to duck, when someone is coming to sack them. Fighter pilots live and die by it. And CIA agents spend years perfecting it. It's sometimes the difference between having a car accident or getting eat to death or avoiding an accident. It's the ability to know when you're being scammed or not. In large cities, it's called being street smart. A great number of children, and we probably could poll the folks here, believe that their mothers have eyes in the backs of their head. They have that situational awareness just to know when something's going wrong. Situational awareness is the ability to be able to scan your surroundings, comprehend their meaning, and then make a split-second decision on how you're going to react. Many experts in the military believe the skill of making quick decisions to be judgmental, a fundamental ingredient for military success, especially in sticky situations or in a case like this, knowing where your enemy is. Another common name for split-second decision-making is thinking on your feet. Now, no matter if you're looking to dominate in a certain sport, fly a jet airplane, parent children today, or walk down a crowded street, situational awareness is critical to our survival. Jesus would actually give an amen to having situational awareness. In fact, in our text from Luke 21, he is doing just that. Jesus, at this point, we have to realize, is only days from going to the cross and dying for our sins. He knows what his fate is, but he wants his disciples to be prepared for what is to come. For the world that they're going to live in is going to be vastly different from the one they are now with Jesus Christ. Jesus was not thinking of himself, but of those that he was going to leave behind. Now, this text begins with the disciples. They're in awe. They're in awe of Herod's temple, of its beauty and of its magnitude and majestic appearance. Now, Herod's temple actually took some 80 years to build. And at this particular time in the life of Jesus, it had 30 plus years yet to go to be finished. But even so, it had such a magnitude and an impression that it would have impressed anyone. In fact, Josephus, a Jewish historian, remarks of the temple's magnitude, saying some of its stones were 12 to 60 feet in length, 7.5 feet high, and some 9 foot across in width. And the temple, as the scripture says, was decorated with extravagant gifts that came from other countries. And Josephus said, the temple loomed over the city like a snow-clad mountain. And I think part of that is because those white stones, and because it rose up above everything else, it really did look like a mountain from a distance. Inadvertently, what the disciples are saying is, surely something so magnificent as this, and God-honoring, that is taking so very long to build, that's going to last a long time, right? God would certainly bless and honor this building, especially one of this magnitude. But can you imagine the shock on their faces when Jesus declares to them, a time will come when not one stone is left on another. Every one of these stones will be thrown down. Surely the disciples thought, Lord, you got to be kidding, right? Now, it's hard for us in the 21st century to catch the full impact of what Jesus said about the temple. We have to remember, for the Jews, this building was the heart and soul of the Jewish place. It was not only the place where they would come to worship and offer sacrifices, it also housed the Holy of Holies, the most sacred place where God, they thought, existed. And for the disciples and the fellow Jews to think of the most of Herod's temple being destroyed seemed unfathomable to them. And ironically, though, most of the disciples lived long enough to actually see this happen. For in 70 AD, the walls did come tumbling down as Emperor Nero called for the destruction of Jerusalem and of Herod's temple. Now, while the disciples' immediate concern in this text is when is this going to happen, Jesus is really trying to point them to a future event that they later believed was going to happen when they finally understood it, that was going to happen even in their lifetime, which is Jesus' second coming. And before Jesus gives them a long list of end time events, what he does is he warns them. He said, false prophets are going to come proclaiming to be Christ and telling you that the time is near. He says, do not be deceived. And then Jesus was preparing the disciples and us really for a time of intense struggle that is coming to the earth, saying there will be wars and rumors of wars. Nation will rise against nation. There will be great earthquakes and famines and disease of all sorts. I mean, who wants to hear these kind of things? Fearful events and great signs from heaven. But Jesus is calling us to be ready and to be watchful about what's going on in the world and to have a sense of a faith-filled situational awareness so we know how to act when we see these things happening and so that we can stand firm in the faith and not have a sense of fear. To have this faith-filled situational awareness, we need to live with what I would call spiritual awareness. Specifically, we need to remember that we are living in increasingly difficult times, especially as a Christian believer. And we need to keep our guard up and be aware of what's happening in the world around us, and that we can quickly discern what's going on and be able to identify what is false truth and what is true. And we need to keep our eyes then on Jesus Christ. The problem, though, is that so many in the world today, even those who claim to be a Christian, often take and wrongly live as though they have an option of opting out of this call to readiness in this text, and rather having a situational awareness, they have what we could call situational apathy. They'd rather stick their head in the sand and just ignore all the signs that Christ is coming. In the same manner, as we look at our Capitol building in Washington, D.C., and we look at its magnitude and its glory, and we might think, well, nothing bad is ever going to happen to our capital. Nothing bad's ever going to happen to our nation. And if we do that, we're really just like the disciples who looked at the Herod's temple and said, that's just going to last forever, surely. Well, this can also lead us to skip right over these texts, like this one in Luke, and say, you know what? I don't think we want to look at this. This is just too gloomy and doomy. And so let's look at our text from Isaiah 65 that Donna read that talks about a new heaven and a new earth. That's talking about all the joy of what is to happen. But that is what's going to happen too. And even in Revelation 21, we often look at that and say, well, we know the future. And I've even said that before. We know the future. God's going to win. It's all going to be okay in the end. But instead, though, of being prepared for what is inevitable to come, we do nothing. And we might do nothing because we think, well, I believe in Jesus Christ. I'm going to have a free ticket to go to heaven, so I don't need to worry about what's happening. But doing nothing is not okay, and that's what Jesus is saying in this text. The end result is that if we have situational apathy, we've missed an opportunity. Jesus tells his disciples and us that being engaged in the raging world around us, even when there's tragedies, is an opportunity for us to witness to Christ, to testify, as he says in Luke 21:13. Jesus is telling us that this broken world will increasingly show itself for what it is, and its form of strife, struggle, and persecution. And as disciples standing in the midst of it, we have a chance to share with our friends, our families, and even those who don't think like us, just why the world is so broken. Why? Because there's sin in the world. And the fact that the one who made it, Jesus Christ, is going to come back and make it all better in the end. And so the goal as Jesus' disciples is to get us ready to produce a peace in us that understands that despite the chaos that's going on in the world around us, God has a plan. And even if the world is struggling around us with wars and earthquakes and fires and deadly disease, and it's going on right now, doesn't mean that the world is outside of God's divine control. In fact, if we are spiritually aware, we will see these fearful events of signs of God's continuing activity in bringing that joyful conclusion that Isaiah talks about and of Jesus' return. This is not a time for us to be driven by fear, for us to go out and, as some do, store up canned goods or maybe invest in gold. We need to trust in God. And actually, to simplify it, situational awareness comes down to three actions. First, we need to expand our worldview by opening our eyes a little wider. You've all heard the old cliche, you want to soar like an eagle, don't run with the turkeys. Now, do you know what that means? It means that if we hang out with all those people and they have no ambition, we will have no ambition. If we hang out with people who always complain all the time, we'll complain all the time. And if we are around people that, if all we listen to is news that is negative and one-sided, well, then we're going to be negative and one-sided. You see, a narrow worldview limits our ability to see what's really going on in the world. Now, either by choice or a limited resource to draw from, we do that. Some of us have the attitude, though, is we're so tired of what's going on in the world. All we see is the negative. All we see of what's happening. We just assume not even listen, not even pay attention to what's going on. But that's not right. Others get their information only from one source. We only listen to, say, Fox or CNN or MSN or maybe just what people post on Facebook. What if we watch things like the BBC World News? I clicked on that the other day. It had all kinds of stuff about what's going on in the world instead of our local news. What if we signed up to receive updates from the voices of martyrs, which we stay updated then on the persecution and the struggles that our Christian brothers around the world are going through? There's a lot happening in the world we just don't pay attention to. And second, when we do face struggles in life, and we will, let us pray not just for them to end, but pray for grace and strength to be able to endure them. Let us have the awareness and maturity to know that many times, but especially in these closing end times, God's going to use this as an opportunity to be able to proclaim his glory. It will also be a time for us to give others an opportunity to draw close to the truth of Christ, not by avoidance of the struggles, but through our witness of enduring through them. And lastly, as we keep our eyes on what's happening in the world around us, let us keep our hearts focused on God's word and promises. Tracy was talking about the importance of God's word this morning in the children's message. The more we know about God's word, the better prepared we will when times come that are difficult and we're having trouble in the world to defend our faith. To give us a sense of assurance, Jesus tells us in Luke 21:18 through 19, remember what he said, not a hair on your head will perish, but by your standing firm you will gain life. Now Jesus isn't saying that none of the disciples or us are ever going to die. Rather, what Jesus is saying that even if we do die, we will live and we will have eternal life. So then, do not fear. Luke is emphasizing that those who cling to the word of God with patience will go out and bear much fruit, and they will be a good witness to the world around them. Furthermore, Luke is making it clear that those who stand firm in the faith will need resolve, will need determination, and the tenacity not to bend to the culture around them as it tries to reshape us and reshape our thinking. And Jesus has warned how bad it's going to get before the end comes. And so we need to have a high sense of spiritual awareness for us to be able to know and to be able to see the signs of the end of the world to come. Remember, everything we see in this world will one day be no more. The only things that will be eternal are the things that are to come in Christ's second coming. God's word is always true. His power is absolute and his promises are certain. Human institutions, no matter how big and luxurious they are, they will fail and they will fall eventually. But when Christ returns to rule on this earth, all will be made right. And so I ask, is your house in order? Jesus is coming again. What if it were today? Are you ready? Amen. And let us pray. Oh God, our Father, we give you praise and glory for all that you have done for us in this world. And as we look around us, we see pain and suffering in this world, and in some cases, it's overwhelming. We turn on the TV or open our newspaper, and we see all sorts of death and disease and despair. At what point do we, at some point, we just want to throw up our hands in the air and just quit. But amid our despair, we are comforted by what you tell us in the scripture today. For Jesus calls us to be ready, to have situational awareness of our surroundings and to see what's happening as a sign of what is to come. Oh Lord, forgive us, for we are not a very patient people. Like the disciples, we want to know when all this is going to take place, when your second coming is going to happen. But we pray for your guidance, that we won't be led astray by false teachers that give predictions and theories that are not biblical. Help us to be good witnesses in difficult times so that others see Christ in us. And Lord, we seek your glory, your presence in both the here and now, and we want our entire being to be filled with overflowing with the power of your Holy Spirit. For, O Lord, we are your creation. We long from the very inmost depths of our souls to be lifted up and to be called children of the Most High. And so, Lord, we wait. And sometimes we wait impatiently, but we wait in the firm hope of the one who has seen the glimpse of the glory that is to come. So today, as we wait, we sing your praise for your glory to come. And we praise and thank you for your word, which you give to us today. And now we lift up those on our prayer chain of concerns. We pray for Sheila Soderquist, who fractured some ribs and is recovering and healing in Countryview Manor. We pray for quick healing. For Mackenzie Ryder, who is dealing with headaches this week and is hoping to get an update appointment in Mayo. We pray that that will happen. We give thanks for Nelvina Popkes, who has returned home, praying for strength and healing for her. And for Jim Travail, who is doing well and recovering from his hip replacement. For Lois Lawrence, who's under hospice care and pain control. And we pray for pain control and quality of life. We pray for Lucille Franson, who is now back at Countryview Manor, who's healing from her fall. And she's hoping to go home soon, so we pray for that. We pray for Muriel Sims' rehab as she continues to get stronger, and her hopes are to go home by Thanksgiving. For Art Cruz, who's in Countryview Manor, we pray for him for quality of life as well. And for Violet Byers, who's undergoing chemo treatment, we pray for healing for her, as well as for Ruth Jurens, as she too battles cancer. And for Eliza Jansma, as he battles his cancer. And Lord, we pray for drier weather so that the farmers can finish the fall harvest and the field work. We pray for their safety and for good weather ahead. We also pray for those who mourn and weep and are suffering from all sorts of loss. And Lord, let them stand firm in your promises, buoyed by the strength that only you can give. Give them comfort and assurance that nothing can separate us from your love. And so we pray for Ronald Ryder and his family at his passing, for Paul and Ryder, his brother and family, as well as Ruby Jansen and family. And any others, Lord, we just pray for prayers of sympathy for them. And loving God, we pray for healing and hope to reign in this world. Wherever there's conflict and war, let there be peace. Where there's hunger and poverty, let there be abundance. Where there's distress and despair, let there be light. And may we stand firm in our faith so that we too can gain eternal life. Now let us pray that prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This time we will continue our worship with the giving of our tithes and our offerings. The reading from 2 Corinthians 8, verses 3 through 5. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. But first of all, they gave themselves to the Lord. Let us pray. O God, our Father, we ask that you would be pleased with these monetary offerings that we lay before you as a symbol of our love and devotion to you and to your church. Give us your servants grace to use these offerings so that your name may be honored among all people and the happiness and prosperity of your church may be increased. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And our close, remain standing for our closing hymn, number 245. Words are on the screen. What if it were today?
In power and love to reign. What if it
Receive now the benediction of our Lord. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said, Amen.